Shamps and giggles, history, news, views, and reviews from a black perspective. Shamps and giggles back for 2024. Oh my lord.
Welcome one and all. Another amazing week. Shamps and giggles. Lord have mercy. The things to review this week, I mean, look, we've got a full house here. Toronto's in the building, Boots is in the building, big up, Pinky in the back, Colour Queen Show, Spice, Alicia, Corner House, Lord have mercy, yeah man, they did that last night at the Corner House in Croydon, big up to the corrupt there, sir. George is in the building, Denise Debart, you know, we have to give a moment to think of those in the group that are experiencing unwellness, they're not well, and it's a few, you know, something. Perhaps we're not going to talk about it on the radio, we have to talk about it privately. But we have to start taking notes because these things are creeping up.
Wow.
You know, it's one thing, it's the other, and it's the next.
Wow.
Keep moaning. It's time of life.
It is time of life, but my goodness, yeah.
Yeah, before you know it, you know, it's true. I mean, off the top of my head, I can think of like five or six people. I'm like, hold on a minute. There's a lot going on. So yeah, we have to give thoughts in that direction and see what we can do, how we can be of service, how we can help. What can we do? You know, sometimes it could be just a phone call. You know, it's simple things. It can be a text. Simple things mean a lot and go very, very far. So we really, really want to give thoughts to that. But for this evening, so much to discuss. Key subjects being the Chris Cubber shooting, I would say.
Yes.
But also, many have now watched Mr. Loverman, the TV series, which has sparked control. I mean, that's what they're meant to do, though. They're meant to spark controversy, really and truly. It has sparked controversy. We will be talking about things. And then there's a few other things I want to give a tribute to, innit? We want to remember, Shamps and Giggles, history, news, views, and reviews from a black perspective. So we want to talk about some of the history, in which case we think of the Voice newspaper and those that have contributed to it. And also we think about the youths there, something to do a review on, and how to help the youths with their life experiences in this day and age. Because the landscape has completely changed in recent times with social media and everybody having a phone that they can access anything from. So, yeah, the youth done my feeling. So it'll be great to get into all those topics. But first of all, Keith, part of the things, tell us what's going on the banter side of things. Congratulations.
Well, yeah. So the first one I wanted to condolence really is one of two. What the first one is Kris Jenner's sister Karen Houghton died 65.
Kris Jenner,
yeah, Kris Jenner, you know, from America, Kris Jenner's sister, Karen Houghton, she died 65 years old. That's in America, but the so our condolences goes out to her. But the main one that I want to for the death for the UK,
Kris Jenner being the mother of.
So
their auntie died.
Yes, 65. Right. But for the UK purposes, Geoff Capes, famous Olympian Geoff Capes,
died.
Yeah, Geoff Capes. He was a formidable man. He used to pull lorries along in the old days with a rope. Geoff Capes.
Britain's strongest man and all the rest of it.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah.
No way. Yeah. That's a terrible news. I remember Geoff Capes. As I said, the name rings a bell.
Rings a bell, yeah.
You know, we can have a sneak preview here. Look. As you see him, very sporting individual, 1949 to 2024, I guesstimate that being about 75 years old.
Yeah.
Yeah, 75 years, yeah. World's Strongest Man and British Shot Book Record Holder. Poor fellow. Any idea what happened?
Well, no. I think they said that he was ill, but I didn't read into. I was just shocked to know that he's passed away. So he was a man that the older generation would have known about, but well liked in the UK. He left and did coaching and all sorts. So
Well, you'd never have recognized him if you saw him.
Not now. Yeah, looking like no.
You know, he spent his days at home and rarely ventured out in the past year. So he'd been unwell for some time. And of course, he lived in a village, so they hadn't seen him around.
Yeah.
But good Lord, yeah. What a different fella.
Who was he?
Geoff Capes. You have to look at him in the back in the day, Olympian.
The shot putter.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, I remember him from the shot putter. For Britain, definitely. Yes.
Yeah, you of course you remembered him.
Gold and silver, innit?
Yeah. Highland Games, famous in the UK. I mean, there's a lot to be said about him. You know, he certainly lived.
But he looked like you get Gordies.
But he had his beard there, as you can see. But I mean, obviously, compare him at that time to here where he is now. Uh-huh. Obviously, the hair color change is going to make all of the difference. Nisha, you got your hands up. Talk to things.
Wow. Strongest man in the world.
Yeah.
You find strength at this point, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. On a Saturday.
Yeah, that's it. Wasn't it World Record Breakers or something he was in as well or something?
Wasn't it wrestling?
Putting the lorry with a rope.
Yeah, World's Strongest Man.
Right.
Yeah.
That's why you get Gordies, man.
Wow. You know what? Some people you've forgotten about.
Yeah.
Here he is, look.
Yeah, pulling the truck. Yeah.
That's right, pulling the truck.
Yeah, man.
Strong man.
Tires, everything they used to do.
Yeah.
Days when men used to be men.
Wow.
A bit like lover man. Yeah.
Yeah.
2,000 calories a day.
Oh,
yeah.
Definitely.
No feminized men then.
Wow, well there's
yeah, I said it.
You know. Wow.
Yeah.
You know, is that how people end up having done all of that athleticism? Do you know, you'd have thought the man them that do all that athletic workout and all the rest of it, you'd think that they're going to live longest.
Yeah, true.
You'd think that them's the man that's going to make it to the 80s and 90s and so on and so forth. 75? You know, one of the things in his case, though, to be fair, when he was eating all that food, working out, so when you stop doing the workout, because he's still a man of size, isn't he?
Yeah, he is of size.
So his diet thereafter, I mean, 12,000 calories a day? That means you stretched your gut for sure. That you still want food, isn't it? And then, of course, you're not doing the workout, the activity. It's going to start putting stress on your body, no?
And that's what's happened with him, it looks like. But depending what illness he had, but I'm not sure if he was able to keep up with his keep fit regime, but
yeah, and of course all of that involved at a point in time it does become 75. It does become difficult to up and run and all the rest of it like you were before. Leisha, your hands up. Fuck the things. I mean, you know what I mean?
Yeah, but I bet his quality of life was very, very good. Like, I mean, he lived quite a long time. It's not as though he passed away in his 40s or 30s. He got to his 70s, 75 years old, which is quite a long stretch.
Yeah.
Wait. We're talking about getting into our 90s. The Queen's husband made it to 97 and he was still driving. Yeah, that's the marker now, mate. 75.
Yeah, but it's the quality, isn't it? It's no use. No, it's not worth. Well, I shouldn't say that. But getting to 90 years old and you're sick and you can't do things, you're not coherent, and all that stuff. You haven't got any money and all that stuff. You're not eating very good. You're 90 years old. Not great quality of life. You've lived a great life and you passed away at 75. Nah, you know. Why? You know, it's not
done well.
Yeah, done well. That's what I say.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, of course, if you get to 75, you've done all right. I mean, you can't, you know, nothing can be said. You've done all right, innit? I mean, I'm, you know, getting past the age of, you know, going through your 50s to 60s seems to, here's Geoff pulling the lorry in the snow. Getting from 50 to 60 seems to be a milestone. You know how much people dead in their 50s now? Not to mention 70. I mean, 70 seems like a gift at this point in time. I mean, of course, you have to give tribute. Yeah, so you get to 75, you're good. Sorry, Alicia. Yeah, I'm good. And get there 75. I'm good, because obviously tomorrow's not guaranteed for any one of us. And yeah, if you make it 75, you're good. You did it. You know what I mean? You did it. Would have had some grandkids behind him. His wife was there strong with him. I mean, he's good. Yeah. He's good. You can't fault 70. You can't fault 75. I mean, a shot putter, television star, Olympian. I knew he was in the Olympics.
Yeah, he was Olympian. Yeah.
And budgie. He breeds budgies. Well, there's a side note. Colour Queen, your hand is up. Type the things.
Yeah, I mean, he did the 3 school years and 10.
Yeah.
Considering what he had put his body through in terms of training and pulling those heavy vehicles and so forth. And to touch on what, like Miss Leisha was saying, 75 years of age is a good age if you are coherent and you can do things for yourself. So people in the royal family, they're going to live, they're going to exceed that because they've not got council tax to worry about. They've not got food to worry about. They haven't got anything like that to worry about. So basically, they've just got to turn up at engagement to a certain degree. But ordinary people who have got everyday things to consider, stress alone is a number one killer. So ordinary people are more likely to be dying of much earlier, you know, in their 50s and their 60s. Remember back in the day, some of the conditions that we are experiencing now, it was for older people. But most of us have got something wrong, whether it's diabetes, high blood pressure, prostate, or whatever. But once upon a time, it was like, oh, you know, my grandma or my grand aunt, you know, she died and she was 90 or something like that. People are still living, but our lives are slightly shorter because of whatever. But yeah, he did good. He did this 3 school years. Then I'm going to live to 100, by the way.
Say again?
I'm going to live to 100 so I can get my
letter. Absolutely.
Yeah, you've got to set a mark.
Absolutely.
And of course,
I'm running to Barbados because if you look in Barbados, that's where they all live to 100.
Yeah. And I'm going to join you.
I'm running off.
May I get Pundit flight?
I've looked in the cemetery. I've actually looked in the cemeteries. No, it's really, it's a fact. You go into the cemetery in the UK and you will find, look and see who's the majority and look and see what the age groups of when they all tailor off.
Hold on, wait, Pinky, that's a bit difficult. If you go to the cemetery, how are you meant to look and see all that information?
You see it on the grave. Well, you see the age.
On the gravestone? Yeah, but that might just be the part of the cemetery that you're in, because...
No. That's what I'm saying. Take a walk through and you'll find... Yeah, a lot of people will tailor off from around them 60s and 70s.
They kill the early.
Yeah, they're really, yeah, they tailor off around there. So 70 is a good age.
We are not our grandparents.
70's a good age. But a cemetery also is a bit misleading.
Our parents and that have lived.
Yeah, they work hard.
Our parents have lived. Right, our grandparents definitely have lived to their 90s. Their 90s and so forth. And some people have people that, you know, they got in their family that have lived to their hundreds. But what I'm saying is, and I mean, some of us still have our parents today. I'm blessed. I've still got my parents. They're in their 80s. Mm. Do you understand? 80-something.
Mm. You blessings, so, indeed, yes.
Yeah, yeah. So that's what I'm saying. I give thanks every day for my mum and,
oh,
and,
absolutely.
And,
absolutely.
And my dad, because they're still alive. So
are they here or them back home?
No, yeah, that's it. One's back home and the other one's in Texas.
Oh, right, in Texas.
My mother's in the Caribbean.
Barbados.
Yeah. And Barbados is the place where they live too long. They live to 100.
No, so, okay, so I'm hearing you. So when you was talking about the funeral, were you talking about, sorry, the cemetery?
Yeah, the cemetery in the UK. In the UK here.
Okay.
And I find that, yeah, you know, it seems like women, when they're by themselves, they tend to live longer stretches. And when they're in the relationship, the women tend to go first. And some of the men will tend to go behind them and some live on for another, you know, maybe 5 to 15 years.
Okay, well, I hear that. I was in the cemetery recently and I noticed there's quite 40-year-olds passing away after that bad boy.
Yeah, I
met a couple of the parents whilst I was in there. She's one of them from Sierra Leone, and she's planning to have her funeral back there. And she was saying that she was depending on him to have arranged everything for her burial. Last thing she thought was that she would be burying him. 45. Then there's another family there.
Came true last night after
a brother, and you see all the thing and son already. And come to find this young lad again, 40 plus. I think it was leukemia. But you know, and then they'll you know, so this graveyard, it just depends on where you look. It's the graveyard will tell you a lot. A lot of mercy. It'll tell you a lot.
Yeah.
But it is where you look, you know, what
you do seem to be going a lot younger in this country. That's what I'm saying.
Well, you need,
statistics. Yeah.
You can't just look in one little patch of the cemetery. You need to know what's going on overall to give them.
That's what I just said to you. Why are you? You're not listening. I said to you, you need to take a walk through the cemetery, and then you will see. You did not listen.
Yeah, that's what I did hear you, but it's more than a walk. You want to get the book. Hold on, Shug's got a hand up because she's trying to talk.
All I was going to say, yeah, but you see, we're in the generation that somebody just took me, shy checked me, but anyway, I was going to say that at the end of the day, we as parents, grandparents, and our parents, we do what we do. We do what we do.
Right.
You know, we do actually do what we do a little bit more. I'm just going to sidetrack. I'm sorry.
I hear you. At Grandpa, we do. Of course, you've got that far. You do what you do. You've done what you can. I mean, it's just things. Yeah, life is really, we're up against it now. Cost of living crisis, all manner of things. All manner of things we are faced with in this day.
Listen, we're not talking about cost of prices because Lidl's gone as bad as
hold on a minute. Keith's got some congratulatory.
Yes, please.
Comments now.
Thanks very much. Yeah, so the next one that I want to congratulate is Pride of Britain, Child of Courage, they class it as. Pride of Britain Award, 25 years, and it happened yesterday, I understand. And there's several people that won Pride of Britain. There's a number of winners for 2024. I want to...
it's not us.
I want to congratulate a particular person. I just want to make sure we do this properly.
Person of age or?
Yes, with the age, which is Aiyla Mota, an 8-year-old black girl. Well, she looks.
How you spell?
Aiyla, A-I-Y-L-A, Mota, M-O-T-A.
Wow!
Oh God!
And she was in the Pride of Britain yesterday.
Yes.
She was one of the winners.
She's one of the winners, yeah. Yeah.
She lost her legs and fingers following a sore throat.
Yes, that's right.
You're lying to me.
Yeah, correct. And she also got sepsis and other ailments, but that's not stopped her from her what she wants to be in life in general. It's not stopped her. It's not dampened her. She's got full of courage at 8 years old.
This little girl here.
See it. Yeah, she'll be on the first page when you look at it. That's her.
Is that why her hand is bandaged?
That's her.
No.
What a beauty, though. She's a beautiful girl.
Clap for
her.
She got prosthetic legs.
Prosthetic legs, yeah, because...
Round of applause, please.
Of course, but hold on, let's keep telling us the story first. Go on,
So, with Aiyla, she lost both legs, had to be amputated, and five fingers to save her life. And that's when she was 5 years old, you know? And she refuses to slow down. So the doctors and them were very... Shugs, you're going to the green room. Shugs, you may need to go in the green room for this rest of this recorded session. So they amputated, but she was, her parents refused to give up on her. So they kept encouraging her to do things and very aware of her inabilities at that time. But they also didn't want it to affect her life growing up, because yes, she's alive. She may have had these ailments and these serious operations, but she was alive, and she's done so well, and it's been recognized by the Mirror newspaper, who conducts these awards for 25 years, and they awarded her one of the Pride of Britain as a child of courage.
Wow.
Yeah. So we need to congratulate her, and we need
poor thing. A little sore throat, you. And then how do you get sepsis from a sore throat? She was just over there in Paddington, and this is only 2023.
Absolutely last year, adorable girl.
Last year, 2023.
She's an adorable little girl.
Yeah. She still has rehab, physio, and occupational therapy.
Yeah.
But is thriving at school, loves gymnastics, horse riding, ice skating, and bowling.
Yes.
So she's probably, what, six or seven, maybe going on eight now, because this is very, very recent.
Yeah.
That just goes to show you, she might be physically handicapped, but her mind certainly isn't.
Definitely not. She got a young mind. She's still alive.
That's the inspiration. You know, her mind is growth and development. So she will go on to just develop.
Yeah, they're encouraging people to watch out for early signs of sepsis. Mm-hmm. Trust your instincts and act fast with sepsis every... Boy, people need to figure out what this sepsis is, because that is... And she's also partially blind because it cut off the blood supply.
Yep.
Oh, an adorable little girl. Oh, yep. So sorry. But again, sometimes a setback is, Les Brown says, a setup for a comeback. And she's coming back strong, isn't she? I mean, good Lord. Well done. Well done. Pride of Britain.
There's a number of winners, but I really wanted to mention her.
This one. Yeah.
Yeah, I really did. Numbers
just
of
five. I mean, a remarkable, five. A remarkable, inspirational little girl. You know, she'd make move anybody to tears.
Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, Keith, you pulled that one out.
Yeah, which is nice.
Left field to say the least.
Yeah.
So it's nice that they have those competitions where they can recognize.
So Vorderman, Carol Vorderman was host, was she?
That's right. Yeah, she was there. And she was also proud with them all and various ones. So, yeah. And it's been going for 25 years. It's always on the telly, you know.
Pride of Britain, yeah. It's every year. I think last year we also gave it a mention. With good reason. Child of courage winner, you know, Aiyla Mota. Yeah. And I'd love to see that. We might have a little clip here of her and the family. There, yeah, we do have a clip of her that we are able to. By the way, Shamps and Giggles, we are on YouTube. So for our radio listeners, if you want to see the show, it gets put out during the week on YouTube. Shamps and Giggles is on YouTube, just thinging Shamps and Giggles. So Aiyla Mota, beautiful, beautiful young girl. And here she is. And she got the Britain's Child of Courage Award.
Both her legs and my fingers after contracting sepsis. And she's the winner of this year's Child of Courage Award.
Simon, where is the award itself? Did you forget it?
Yeah, sort of.
Well, I know somebody who doesn't forget anything, and he is bringing on your award. Do you like Paddington?
Yeah.
Yes! Here he is, Paddington! Is that the...
Child of Courage Award winner, and deservedly so, Aiyla. It's so lovely to meet you. Have you had a very exciting week?
Yes.
I think you have. And what about you, Yolanda?
Yeah.
A bit overwhelming,
yeah.
I guess. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's an extraordinary story, Yolanda, and it's one that you want people to know about because you're trying to raise awareness about sepsis in young children, because a lot of people do not know the signs.
No.
And if you can just take us back, I mean, you were just 3 years old when Aiyla said she had a sore throat.
Yeah.
Very common.
Yeah.
What happened next?
She had like normal cold-like symptoms. So, you know, I rung 111 and gave the symptoms, and they said, you know, just keep an eye out. If anything like develops further, then you can go and seek like medical help. So at that point she was unwell, but at home I thought it was like, you know, manageable and she was okay. But within 24 hours, her symptoms had developed rapidly. And it was when I noticed her rapid breathing, which is when I knew like she needed to be seen in hospital, and we took her to hospital.
Mm-hmm. And then, of course, it's when everything started. And you're obviously being positive and hopeful and everything else. But sadly, it was a very, very tough time.
Yeah.
And what did the doctors have to say at that point? Because it had developed so quickly by the time you had actually got to the hospital.
Yeah, so our local hospital wasn't actually able to give Aiyla the care she needed. So they transferred us to a trauma hospital in London. Mm-hmm. And they put Aiyla in an induced coma, so they was able to manage how unwell she was. Mm-hmm. And she was asleep for 3 weeks. Yeah.
Incredibly, incredibly stressful for you. And unfortunately, at the back of that 3 weeks, that's when you had to have this very difficult conversation with the doctors. How did they approach that with you, Yolanda?
I mean, they kept telling us, like, she's really unwell. You know, she needs a lot of care for right now. And I think at the time, I was, like, in disbelief. Like, I wasn't really trying to hear what they was trying to say. But she was really well to the point they wasn't sure if she was going to survive.
My goodness me. And then, of course, the doctors had to explain that for moving forward and for her health moving forward, it was all about having to, sadly, it was legs and five fingers.
Five fingers.
At that point, of course, I mean, you know, terrible time for the family trying to come to terms with it. But in that moment, you were like, I've got my little girl.
Yeah.
And you considered yourself to be incredibly lucky.
Oh, 100%.
And the doctors, of course, they all did such a brilliant job. And at the other end of this, and you've come so far since then, you almost feel like you've got a bigger, more wonderful Aiyla.
Yeah, like, even before she went in hospital, she was, like, a big character. But now, like, she's even more, like, even braver, even kinder, even stronger than she was when she was free. So
exactly, yeah. And has just moved on and come on so much in that time. And you're year one, aren't you, Aiyla?
Yes.
And you love lots of things. So tell me, what's the hobby wise? You love gymnastics,
ballet,
dancing,
singing.
Everything, basically. You just throw yourself into everything, don't you? And you've got a big dream, and this big dream is to get blades.
Yes.
There's a lot of discussion about this, isn't it? And why is that such an exciting prospect, Yolanda?
Well, I think it's mainly because you want to be able to run really fast, don't you?
Yes.
You do, don't you? There's no stopping you at all. Tell me what it was like meeting Simon Cowell and, more importantly, Paddington.
Fun.
Was it fun? Because you'd been to the BGT sort of show itself, hadn't you? And Alicia had taken you around. So you'd had a little insight into the world of Simon Cowell. And here he was then presenting you with an award. It was quite a moment. But we all know that the Pride of Britain winners go to Downing Street the next day to meet the Prime Minister. Tell us what happened, Yolanda.
Well, Aiyla slept in until about 10:30, so we didn't actually make it, did we?
Nah.
Aiyla. You were partying so much at the Pride of Britain the night before. That's what happened, isn't it? It was worth it, though, wasn't
it? Yeah, it really
was. Absolutely. And it's been an incredible week for you because of that. Hilary, it's rapidly
Child
in the word.
Of Britain, Child of Courage.
Courage,
Award winner, Aiyla Mota.
Yeah.
Wow. That's something, huh? So she's about five, yes.
Five, yeah.
Sepsis, according to Alicia, when the body's immune system overreacts to an infection or an injury. And so it's an overreaction. So it's just one of those, oh my goodness, days in that there's good news. You know, in the good news, there's obviously, you know, it's how do you get it? How do you bring it all together? Wow. Okay, Shamps and Giggles, we go to break. We'll be back after these words. Wow.
Oh, bad tune. Oh, my goodness. How do you know this tune, Joe? Oh, my goodness.
Catch you guys later.
I've
got to go to work now.
All right, Jimmy.
Bad joke.
Jeez.